Good morning, Greater Fellowship, and welcome to the Ship Virtual. We're so excited to see your beautiful smiling faces one more time. You woke up this morning. That means you ought to give God some praise. Are you glad you're alive this morning? If you're glad you're alive, I need you to put amen in the comment section right now. Hey, is this your first time worshiping with us? It's your first time viewing us? I need you to do me a huge favor. Down in the comment section, I need you to type two words, first time. If this is your first time, we want to love on you. Hey, we don't forget our returning guests either. If you're returning, this is your second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, you just keep on coming back because it keep on getting gooder and gooder. We want to love on you as well. Type down in the comment section, two words, I'm back. We want to love on you as well. All right, listen, it's time for our meet and greet moment. We want to go into this experience. Do me a huge favor. Say hello to somebody who's a first-time guest. Say hello to somebody who's a returning guest. Or just say hello to somebody who you used to sit beside in church in 2019. So as we go into this meet and greet moment, I want to share some things with you. Meet and greet. Our youth have some resources that are available to them online. If you visit our website, greaterfellowship.org, you can find all of those resources. You can click that button that says Youth and Children Resources. They are updated weekly for our children to engage the Word of God. Did you know that we have a YouTube page? Yes, we are live on YouTube right now. And so if you want to view us on YouTube, go to our YouTube page, type in YouTube, Greater Fellowship Charlotte, and my face will pop up and you'll see that we have a page. I want you to subscribe to that page and I want you to hit that bell so that you can get some notifications and anytime that we decide to go live. All right. Don't forget, we have Bible study on Thursday night's Bible study at 7 p.m. where we're digging deeper into God's Word. Guess what? It's a different kind of Christian that come to Bible study. And I believe that's the kind of Christian you are. You're a mature Christian that wants to study God's Word for yourself. So join us on Thursday night for Bible study. All right, are you celebrating a birthday this week? We want to celebrate you. Do me a huge favor. If you're celebrating a birthday this week, I need you to type in the comment section your birthday. If you want to tell us how old you are and you want to drop the cash out, we'll do it. Go ahead and do it right down in the comment section. Go ahead and drop that down there now. When is your birthday? We want to celebrate you. Happy birthday to you. Hey, are you celebrating a wedding anniversary this week? Did you get hitched some time ago? Year, two, three, 15, 20, 50? How long ago was it? How long have you been married and who have you been hitched to? Type down in the comment section if this is your wedding anniversary week. We want to love on you and we say happy anniversary to you. All right. You know what time it is. It's time for the Word. But I've got a special guest for you today. My brother and friend, Pastor William Robinson. He is the pastor of the Hayden Baptist Church in Aiken, South Carolina. He's my brother from another mother, and he's a preacher par excellence. So after Rudy comes and blesses us, our artist in residence, with a word through song, he's going to bless us with a word through the Word. Amen. All right, so let's get ready. It's time for the Word.
Had enough heartaches, and I've had enough headaches. I've had so many ups and downs. I don't know how much more I can take, but I decided that my last year yesterday. Lord. Now either I'm gonna trust you or I may as well walk away. The stress, don't make it better. Don't make it better, no way. But I cried. I decided that I cried my last year only yesterday. Yesterday. trust in you. Oh, yesterday. That you, nobody but you see me through. There ain't nothing, no, nothing too hard for God. Every problem that I have, y'all, He's greater than them all. So you ought to make up in your mind. I cry my last tear. I cried it on yesterday. I wish I had somebody to sing that with me. Yesterday. Woo. Oh, I decided to put my trust in you. Oh, yesterday. Yesterday. No, nobody but you see me through. There ain't nothing. Stay right there, y'all. No problem that you may have, no matter what you're going through. Ain't nothing. Nothing too hard for God. No matter what you're going through out there, I found out that God is greater than them all. So I made up in my mind to give it to Jesus. Oh, you and you out there, you ought to make up in your mind. Oh, you gotta let it go and hold unto God's changing hand. Oh, don't give up. Oh, I made up in my mind that I cried my last tear. I stopped complaining about it. I gave it to Jesus. I stopped worrying about it. Cried my last tear on yesterday. Give it to Jesus. That sickness you've been worrying about, give it to Jesus. That problem you've been worrying about, give it to Jesus. Your finances, you ought to give it to Jesus. No, nobody can do it like Jesus. Yes to your will and yes to your way. I cried. Somebody been crying all night long, yeah. You've been praying a long time. Oh, I cried. God's saying I'm getting ready to move on your behalf. Oh, because you've been faithful over a few things. I cried. God said, I'm getting ready to wipe the tears from your face. I cried. I cried my last tear. I cried it on yesterday.
Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We greet you in the wonderful name of Him, the one that alters our footsteps and meets all of our needs. And beside Him, there is no other. To the Greater Fellowship Missionary Baptist Church family, it is such a great honor to be with you all virtually during this worship experience. And to your pastor, the Reverend Dr. George Franklin Shears III, along with Lady Kaya Shears III, and the newborn Wyatt Franklin Shears, along with Mason Franklin Shears as well. We greet you all in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. I do believe that there is a word from the Lord. And if you will go with me today, I believe we can go somewhere. Let's go to the book of Luke chapter 9. And I want to read starting at verse 57. And I'll be reading from the New King James Version. And it reads like this. Now it happened as they journeyed on the road that someone said to him, Lord, I will follow you and wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, foxes have holes. And birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Then he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God. And another also said, Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and bid them farewell who are at my house. But Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. For a few moments, I just want to talk from this subject. This time, don't look back, but keep it moving. As we look at this particular chapter in the book of Luke chapter 9, we know Luke to be that great and wonderful physician, the one who pens this particular book of Gospel of Luke, one who has written a third of the New Testament scriptures, and we know him to be a doctor because Paul addresses him as such in the book of Colossians chapter 4. Here in Luke, he focuses on a lot of miracles and signs and healing that Jesus deals with in his particular context. And while we're here in Luke chapter 9, as I'm looking at this particular text, it amazed me because Jesus is talking to individuals that are following his ministry. They are following his life. And they're paying attention to him closely, and they're admiring the work that he's done, and they want to follow him, and they don't realize the cost that it takes in order to follow Christ. There is a cost to following him. There is a price to following the Messiah. And one has to be willing, one has to be able, and one has to have the commitment to make that choice in their mind that I have decided to follow Jesus. The old hymn writer said, no turning back, no turning back, no turning back. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem to be prepared for his crucifixion, for his death. And while he's on his way there, he gives word ahead that he's coming through and that he's going to stop in a place, in a village in Samaria. And there in a small village in Samaria, his disciples go ahead, and while they are preparing for him to come, when he gets there, the people are not receptive of him. They are not welcoming of him. Well, James and John, y'all know some of y'all got some James and John in y'all life. James and John wanted to retaliate, like, what's going on, Jesus? And Jesus rebuked them and say, don't worry about that. He said, let's just go to another village. And here we look at one text that says he told them to kick their dust off of their feet, the dust from their place, the dust at where the people that did not want to welcome them, he told them to kick their dust off of their feet and keep it moving. One of the things that I realized, in order for one to continue to move forward in life, you've got to be able to dust some stuff off. You've got to be able to dust some haters off. You've got to be able to dust your enemies off. You've got to be able to dust some jealous folks off. There are some things that you've just got to learn how to be able to dust off, because there was a time, and there have been many a times and several times, that you've allowed the enemy to pull you in places that you knew were not good for you, to pull you in places that really did not have your best interest at heart. And God said that you've grown up a little bit. You've seen some things. You've paid attention to some things. And because you've watched how people have treated you in the past and how things have went in the past, this time you've got to make up in your mind not to go back there, not to go back to that same situation. But you've got to learn how to kick the dust off your feet, the dust off of your feet, the dare dust off of your feet, and keep it moving. And while he keeps it moving, and while him and the disciples are on their way, he didn't have a following coming with him, a following that want to follow him, a following that want to go with him, because they saw, hallelujah, the anointing on his life. They saw his ministry. They saw all the signs and the wonders, and they wanted to be a part of it. And Jesus had to let them know, if you're going to be a part of this, you've got to learn, understand, and know that it's going to cost you something. And one thing you've got to understand and realize, that in life, when you have not only come to a point in your life where things in your life, things in your past has cost you something, not more so for the good, but have cost you something for the bad, you've got to learn to make some decisions in your life that's going to cause you to get to a place called better. I don't know about you, but I don't want to come down 30 years or so in my life. I don't want to come to a rightful old age in my life and I'm still holding on to the same grudge. I'm still holding on to the same people that did not accept me, to the same people that did not want to deal with me, the same people that did not want to accept me for who I am. You've got to realize there are some things you've just got to learn. Come on, I can't hear nobody talking to me, or I can't hear nobody commenting to me. You've just got to learn, hallelujah, to shake off. And in order for you to shake those things off, you've got to understand the point of following Jesus. When you're following Jesus, you're following your purpose. When you're following Jesus, you are going into a place that's going to make your life better, that's going to make your wealth better, that's going to make your health better, that's going to make your peace better. And in order for you to do that, you've got to, hallelujah, I can't hear nobody saying that. I'm used to having a crowd speak back to me, or somebody to say amen, but I know I can get some amens in the comment section. But you've got to understand and realize there's a choice that you've got to make in order for you to get to greater. Somebody say greater. Somebody type greater there. And so it is that he comes and these individuals, they want to follow him. They are shooting him with good words. Oh, I want to walk with you. I want to go. How many have been there before where people say they want to get with you? They want to be a part of what you got going on. They want to be a part of your business. They want to be a part of your ministry. They want to be a part of your family. But when you start giving them, come on, I can't hear nobody talking to me. When you start giving them the qualifications, when you start giving them the requirements that it takes, come on, to be a part. I mean, come on, I can't hear nobody talking to me. One thing we've got to learn to understand, my brothers and sisters, there are some requirements to hanging with me. There are some requirements to being a part of me. There are some requirements to being a part of where God is trying to take me. Are y'all praying with me here today? You've got to understand that there are some requirements, hallelujah, and some costs, hallelujah, that has to be paid if you're going to go where I'm going. If you're going to go where I'm going, you've got to understand, hallelujah, you've got to learn and realize that there's some things, hallelujah, that you're just going to have to avoid in order for you not to look back this time. And so Jesus come to him, and he's talking to them. He says to another man, follow me. But the man replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. I know that seems a little harsh. I know that seems a little harsh where Jesus come and he replies to him, let the dead bury their own dead, as if Jesus really don't care about people dying. You know, there's some people, you know, don't show up to certain people's funerals because they may have to work and people have their panties in a bunch about that. And people, well, they could have showed up at their own, you know, cousin's funeral or whatever the case may be. And some people look at it like this. If they were still here, they would be going on about their life. They would be going on about their business. They would want you to go about the same day. And I understand paying respect. But when it comes down, hallelujah, to this life, hallelujah, Jesus is simply saying, I want you to not get caught up, hallelujah, in dead stuff. He said, because what it does is when people, hallelujah, are grieving, hallelujah, I wish I get somebody to understand here. We definitely want to mourn with them that do mourn, but you don't want to get to a place, hallelujah, where you're mourning and your grief because you stay there. Because once you get there, there are some things that'll lock you in. And Jesus said, just let them bury, hallelujah, let the dead bury their own dead. But you come, hallelujah, watch this, you come and you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Because if you get there, you might get stuck there. But you've got to realize, in order for one to move forward and not look back, number one, you've got to learn how to avoid dead weight. He said, you've got to learn how to avoid dead weight. There are some of you that are watching me right now, that there are some things that continue to try to attach itself to you. There are some dead situations that attempt to try to attach itself to you, and it's trying to assassinate you and trying to suck the life out of you. But God told me to tell you, you've got to learn how to avoid dead weight. If you're going to plow, if you're going to put your hand to this mission, if you're going to put your hand to this vision, if you're going to put your hand to this career, if you're going to put your hand to this business, hallelujah, you've got to understand, you've got to put your hands to the plow, but you can't look back. In order for you to continue to do the work of him that sent you, you've got to avoid dead weight. He says, avoid dead weight. That's what I pick up here. He says, avoid dead weight. And because you got to understand that there's life and death in your tongue. The power of life and death is in your tongue. I can't hear nobody talking to me. And a lot of people, and I don't want to stick too far on that, because a lot of people, it just appeases me at times when I see people in situations when death come, and when people have to prepare for funerals and things of that nature. And it seems as if people love that type of attention. I can't hear nobody talking to me. I can remember my grandmother sharing with me and sharing with many of us and our children. She said, when I'm gone, when I die and gone, don't you be coming out of that cemetery, standing up out that cemetery, sitting around and all this, because I ain't going to be there no more. I'm not there. The corpse is there, the body, but my soul is gone. I can't hear nobody talking to me. And that's simply what I'm trying to get you to understand, that when you have sense enough to know, hallelujah, who controls the future, who controls, hallelujah, your journey, who controls everything that you got, you'll be able to learn how to let some stuff go, move forward, and avoid dead weight. He said, not only do you need to avoid dead weight, but watch what he says as he goes on, and he still sees another. He talks to another. He says, I will follow you, Lord. Hallelujah. Another comes to him. He want to make his claim of how he's going to follow him, or how he's going to, you know, go with him. And he said, I will follow you, Lord. But first, let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Let me first go back and say, hallelujah, goodbye to my family. Let me bid farewell to those at the house. I can't hear nobody talking to me. One thing I've come to understand, that what happens is that the many reasons why many people cannot move forward in their life, cannot go to the next level in their life, cannot go to the next place in their life, number two, is because they get so consumed and so caught up in familiar, unhealthy relationships. I love my mother and my father. I love my family. But what I've come to understand, if you're not careful, your family can be the very thing that calls you, I can't hear nobody talking to me, that causes you not to make it to that place that God is trying to take you. And even though many of them mean well, even though many of them oftentimes have their best interests at heart, most of the time they're not realizing that they're holding the very thing back that can eventually help them in the future. I can't hear nobody talking to me. How can you say that? Let me just point it here. Jesus, hallelujah, after he had spoken to his disciples in the book of Matthew, where he begins to ask them the question, who the men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And the disciples said, one said, Jeremiah, some say Elijah, one say one of the prophets, but he steps out and said, who do you say that I, the Son of Man, am? And Peter steps out and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, wow, Peter, flesh and blood, can I have told you this, but my Father, which is in heaven. He said, now, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the very gates of hell shall not prevail against thee. And he said, for I've given you the keys to the kingdom. Whatsoever you shall bound on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Right after all of that, right after all of that Holy Ghost, right after all of that anointing, right after all of that gifting, he goes to next and he's telling Peter what he's getting ready to do, where he's getting ready to sojourn on to, what's getting ready to happen, what's getting ready to take place. And Peter said, no, Jesus, I will not allow that to happen. Now, I will not let them kill you, not realizing that he's trying to stop the very thing that's going to save him. That's not only going to save him, but the very thing that was going to save you and I. Hallelujah. I can't hear nobody saying that. Comment in the section. And what we've got to be careful is that family, familiar relationships can stop you. I can't hear nobody, can stop you from reaching the potential that God has for you and the purpose and the plan that God has for you. That's why you've got to make sure you avoid familiar, unhealthy relationships, that even though there's some family and some people in your family, in your bloodline, and even just people and friends, that those friends that have become family, oftentimes those relationships are unhealthy for where God is trying to take you. If you're trying to be in good health and trying to be in good wealth, but they still eating the same, I can't, ain't working out, ain't trying to work out, ain't trying to do better with that, ain't trying to have a meal plan. Come on, that's unhealthy. You don't need that if you're going to get to the next place in him. If they are trying, I can't hear nobody say, I wish somebody would comment that. You've got to avoid familiar, unhealthy relationships, people that always gossip all the time and ain't having no productivity behind the talk. I can't hear nobody. All they want to do is just gossip all the time. You've got to be careful about familiar, unhealthy relationship. People that are always bringing up the same issue. You got the same issue. Watch this. Everybody's the problem. Come on. But you got the same issue and haven't realized yet that that issue might just be you. You want everybody to do what you want them to do. You want everybody to feel your pain and to feel that you, the way you want them to feel. But nobody, hallelujah, nobody can't feel or have any pain but you. You've got to learn how to avoid those type of familiar, unhealthy relationship, because it can cause you to look back, and you can't look back in this season because your life depends on it. Your life depends on it. Your children's life depend on it. Hallelujah. The people that are in your group, in your camp, their life depend on it. The people that are working and connected to your business, their life depend on it. So you've got to learn how to avoid familiar, unhealthy relationships. Not only do you have to learn how to avoid familiar, unhealthy relationships, but you've got to learn, number one, to avoid dead weight. Hallelujah. Because if you continue to hold on, hallelujah, to dead weight, not only is that a burden, but then now you got unhealthy, come on, unhealthy relationships, unhealthy issues, and people that continue to keep pouring unnecessary things into you. It can cause you to give up and take your hand off the plow. Hallelujah. Now watch what it says. It says, if one puts his hand to the plow and then look back. The only way, what I've come to realize is what happens is the more you get things in your spirit, the more you hear things, the more you get distracted by things. I can't hear nobody talking. It can cause you, hallelujah, to look back. But tell somebody, don't look back this time. Move forward, move forward, move forward. Because Jesus lets us know that if you put your hand to the plow and keep your hand to the plow, he got some things stored up for you. He got some things stored up for the upright. Right, I can't hear nobody talking. He has some things that he has promised for you, and you don't want to forfeit your promise because you're still holding on to past pain, to past hurt, to past issues, to past unresolved conversations, unresolved complaints that had nothing to do with you. Just somebody, you got to avoid it. You got to avoid dead weight. You got to avoid familiar, unhealthy relationship. But watch what he says. He goes further as he talks to one, then he talks to another. Jesus replied to him after he told him, hallelujah. He says to him, but first let me go back and say goodbye, farewell to my family. Jesus replied to him and said, no one puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. my last point, my brothers and sisters, I'm gonna try to cut through here. I hope I've said something to you that will bid you farewell and help you through this. But the third thing I want to share with you, the third point that I want to leave with you, is that you've got to learn how to avoid unnecessary distractions. You've got to learn how to avoid unnecessary distractions. Yeah, I believe that this pandemic has helped many of us, not just some of us, but I believe this pandemic has helped many of us from those unnecessary distractions that we had when the world was so busy and you didn't have time, all the time in a day to get to some important things. You didn't have all the time in the day to pray. You didn't have all time in the day to read a scripture because you had to go to this appointment, you had to go to that appointment, you had to be on this job, and you had to go to this career, you had this meeting, you had to meet up for this lunch, you had to meet up for this party, you had to do all of these things, and you just didn't have the time of the day. But this pandemic helped show, hallelujah, helped show us and helped strip us, hallelujah, hallelujah, of how and what we should really be doing. Thank God for this pandemic, because I believe that this pandemic has caused many of us, hallelujah, to keep our eyes on the prize. I believe that this pandemic has helped many of us. Hallelujah. I can't hear nobody talking to me. Even though if some things was a scare tactic, even with all of the things that are going on and how we feel about certain things, I believe that this pandemic, hallelujah, has allowed many of us, hallelujah, to avoid certain dead weights. It has allowed us to avoid, hallelujah, come on, familiar, unhealthy relationship, because we don't want to gather. We can't gather like we used to. We can't meet up like we used to. We can't get to the places that we needed to. So the pandemic has helped you, hallelujah, refocus and keep your hands on the plow, but not more so keep your hands on the plow, but keep your eyes on the prize and look forward in order for you to get to the place that God has destined for you. So you've got to learn how to avoid unnecessary distractions. Come on, hallelujah. If you can only imagine someone holding their hand to the plow, hallelujah. If you understand anything about farming, if you've never experienced, but if you've seen some type of movies that illustrates or shows someone farming and how they've had their hands, both hands on the plow with the strap, hallelujah, around their waist and the horse connected to the plow and the horse moving, and they gave directions and instructions, that none of them, if you look at it, they kept their eyes on the plow to make sure that they were keeping the line straight in the garden in order for them to have a great harvest. I can't hear nobody talking to them, because you want to make sure, hallelujah, that if you're going, hallelujah, hallelujah, to grow crop, you've got to have a designated line, a designated row for the crop. You can't just have a crooked line and wiggle it here and wiggle there, but you got to have a line straight, hallelujah, and right for growth. You got to understand that there's some things, hallelujah, that you've got to put your time into, you've got to put the effort into, you've got to put the work into. It's going to cost you some things if you're going to go to greater. So number one, you've got to avoid dead weight. Number two, you've got to avoid familiar, unhealthy relationship. Number three, you've got to avoid unnecessary distractions. Listen, I want you to get this in. I'm getting ready to get out of here. And the reason why I want you to get this, because my brothers and sisters, we're living in a time and a moment that's very pivotal for all of us. This is a great time for the believers to be living in, that God is shifting, hallelujah, miracles, hallelujah, signs and wonders in the atmosphere. Hallelujah. He is turning things around in your favor, but you've got to make sure you keep your eyes on the prize. You got to avoid those unnecessary distractions, those voices in the wind. Avoid, hallelujah, those healthy, unhealthy, familiar relationships. You ain't got to go down there. I'm trying to help somebody here. You ain't got to go to the cookout. Hallelujah. I know they keep calling you and seeing if you're going to come, but you ain't got to go down there. You ain't got to reply back to the text message. You ain't got to reply back to the email. You ain't got to reply. You ain't got to pick up the phone call. I can't hear nobody like talking to me. And even when they say they tried to call you, hallelujah, all you got to do is just shake it off. Yeah. I was busy. I had some things going on. I was staying focused, and I'm still staying focused because I know that there's something great in store for me. I got to get out of here, and I feel my health through here. I wish I had an organ in my ear. Hallelujah. But y'all can help me right through here. But as I look at this, as I get ready to get out of here, I'm familiar, hallelujah, that this time around, hallelujah, we've got to make sure we don't look back, but we got to keep moving forward. Somebody say move forward. Keep on moving. Keep on trucking. Keep on pushing. Tell somebody, you ain't got time for the distractions. You ain't got time for the unhealthiness. You ain't got time for the dead situation, the dead weight. You ain't got time for that, hallelujah, because there's something, hallelujah, that you're pressing towards. Hallelujah. There's something that you're moving towards. I can't hear nobody talking to me. And what you understand that it takes faith in order to move forward. It takes faith, hallelujah, faith, hallelujah, in the word of God. Faith in what you hear and not what you see. Hallelujah. Faith beyond your situation that's going to get you to where you're going to. Hallelujah. But I'm reminded of a movie, hallelujah, that's featured on Netflix. And many of you are familiar with that movie that's familiar, hallelujah, that's ran on Netflix. Sandra Bullock is there, hallelujah. And I believe it's a Trayvante Rose that's featured in this movie by the name of The Bird Box. The movie Bird Box, it shows us, hallelujah, a way to operate in faith. A way, hallelujah, to avoid dead weight. Y'all gonna help me here. A way, hallelujah, to avoid familiar unhealthy relationships. A way to avoid unnecessary distractions. That even though they could not see, hallelujah, with their physical eyes, because if they use their physical eye lens, hallelujah, they could, hallelujah, be demonized. They could be departed into. They could be pulled away, hallelujah, from their purpose. And the purpose and the plan was to get to a place that was better than they were in. To get to a place that was better than the chaos that they were dealing in. Everybody on every side were getting caught up, hallelujah, in the situation of the bird box. Hallelujah. When you looked around, somebody, hallelujah, they were trying to keep them focused. Don't look out the window, because if you look out the window, hallelujah, it's going to get you. If you look out the window, hallelujah, it's going to take over you, hallelujah. And every time they tried to remind people, hallelujah, not, hallelujah, to avoid the window, to avoid from looking outside, to avoid from looking at the light. I can't hear nobody talking. Most people got weak and desperate in their knees, and it caused them to get consumed in it. And so Sandra Bullock, along, hallelujah, with her kids and all that played in the part, they found out that if they put on some blindfolds. If they put on some blindfolds and all they had to do was just listen. Not only did they have to listen, all they had to do was listen for the sound. I wish I had some people to hear what I'm saying. All they had to do was listen for the sound. And there were certain pathways that had already been made before they even started the journey. I wish somebody would see that. There are already some pathways that already have been set before you for your journey that some people have already gone through to let you know that you can come through too. There are some pathways that have already been made. That's why you can't look back this time, because there are some floor plans, some blueprints that have already been laid out before you. Hallelujah. And all you've got to do is just trust the process in order for you to get there. There have been many times that the children, hallelujah, wanted to look. There are many times that the children wanted to take off the blindfold. But Sandra Bullock made sure, hallelujah, that the children stayed on the course. I can't hear nobody talking. I can't hear nobody commenting to me. I wish somebody would come back to me, hear what I'm saying, that they were there, and while they were on the journey, hallelujah, they kept listening. They could not see naturally, but all they could do was hear and listen for the word. They had to listen for a voice in their ear in order for them to get to their place of destiny. And when they got there, hallelujah, you understand the movie, hallelujah, they went through this way, they went through that way, hallelujah, they went through danger seen and unseen, until they got to that place. And when they got to that particular place, there, glory to God, they got there to that particular place. Hallelujah. When they got there, the place that they were in, that was a safe haven. That was a place of betterment than the world was. That place of destiny, that place of comfort, that place of richness, that place of wholeness. When they got to this particular place, they were filled with other people that were there. And most of those people that were there, they were blind naturally, but they could see spiritually. And one of the things, hallelujah, about the safe haven that protected them, glory to God, I wish you would see what I'm saying, those that are familiar with the movie, that when they got to the courts, when they got to the center, this place, when they got into the building, hallelujah, people were able, hallelujah, to live a normal life in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of evilness. They were able to live. The children were able to go to school and to function. Hallelujah. Families were able to act as normal in this place. That's why I'm trying to get you to understand. That's why you can't get caught up in this and consumed in distractions, but you got to stay focused and stay focused on Him. Hallelujah. How can I stay focused on Him if I'm in a bird box situation? Hallelujah. For the Bible lets us know. And I got to get out of here, but I thank Luke for helping us. But I'm going to ask Paul to come and help close us out. But I'm reminded in the book of Philippians chapter 3, verse 13, where Paul said, brethren, I count it not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind me and reaching forth unto those things which are before me. Verse 14, y'all know our key verse here. I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I press towards the mark. Hallelujah. What is your mark? I press towards the mark of good health. I press towards the mark of good wealth. I press towards the mark of my peace. And I press towards the mark of a great relationship, a great relationship with Him. Whatever your mark is, forget those things that are behind you. And this time, don't look back, but bust the move to your wealth, bust the move to your health, and bust the move to your peace, because I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. Somebody comment, yeah. I can't hear nobody saying that. I can't see nobody commenting back to me. But if there's anybody here, if you don't understand the one thing that I'm saying to you, but this time around, you've got to avoid dead weight. You've got to avoid familiar, unhealthy relationships. And you've got to avoid unnecessary distractions in order for you to keep your hand, hallelujah, in God's hand. Keep your hand in God's unchanging hand, because God will take care of you. Won't he do it? Shout yeah. Yeah. Yes, he will. I'm so glad that God will keep me and cover me through anything that I'm going through. I know he's got my back, and I'm going to stay, hallelujah, on the course that is laid for me. Let us pray. Father, we bless you. We thank you for what you have shared with us in this moment. I pray that it's touched and reached your people. Hallelujah. In ways that I know not how, but in ways you do know. I pray, Father, this will push them to be better and to stay the course and to keep their eyes stayed on you. Because we understand that when we keep our minds stayed on you, you'll keep us in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee. We thank you for what you're doing, getting ready to do. It's in Jesus' name we pray and believe. Everybody come and say amen. Go in peace. Go in peace. God has heard thee. God bless you.
Wow. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Pastor Robinson, boy, you set this thing on fire today. It's decision time. On your screen, you'll see some options that are available. There's a question there. Where are you in your relationship with Jesus? I want you to put that down in the comment section. Are you an A, you a B, C, or D? Not trying to get in your business, we're just trying to make you aware of where you are. Are you an A, a B, a C, or a D? Type that down in the comment section. We want you to just make that declaration on today. Maybe you're not interested in making a public declaration. That is absolutely fine. Visit our website, greaterfellowship.org, and down at the bottom, you'll see this silver circle, and I want you to click on that silver circle. It's going to take you through the steps of salvation to help you get in touch with Christ, and we can get in touch with you to help you walk with the Lord. Or maybe you don't want to do that. You want to talk to somebody directly, more direct. Why don't you text Jesus to this number in the corner? Text Jesus to 704-741-1616, and we can get you the plan of salvation and help you walk through with Christ. Here's what we want you to do. We simply want you to just make a decision, because your relationship with Christ is the most important relationship that you can have in this world. Let me say a prayer for you. Father, we thank you for those that have made decision and have the courage to do it publicly, or those who want to do it privately. We pray right now in Jesus' name that you'll cover and keep them. Amen. Come on, let's get some hallelujah hands in the comment section. Give them hallelujah hands for those that have made decision on today. We thank God for them. On your screen, you'll see some options that are available to you to give. There are multiple ways that you can give. Find an option that's easiest to access for yourself. Take a screenshot if you're on your cell phone or you're on a tablet. Take a screenshot of it so you can have it for later. But we want you to give. It's tithes and offering. And it's better to give than to receive. It's still better to give than receive. Yes, it is. So go ahead and sow your tithes and your offering at this time. Okay, that's it for this experience this week. I know you're blown away. I know your soul has been set on fire. We thank you for joining us. And do me a huge favor. Drop this in somebody's inbox. Send this to somebody and say, "Ooh boy, ooh child, you got to listen to this." Send it to somebody and drop this in somebody's inbox and share it on your public page. It will bless somebody. If it blessed you, it's going to bless somebody else. All right. I send you love from above, and I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. You're blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed coming. You are blessed going. You're blessed in any and everything that you do. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us henceforth, now and forevermore. God bless you. Amen, amen, and amen again. We'll see you soon.